Tonight, we launch a year-long series focused on finding solutions to some of the country's most pressing racial issues. We're calling it Race Matters, and special correspondent Charlayne Hunter-Gault will be our guide. She begins tonight with a conversation with Harvard University visiting professor Raj Chetty, a recipient of a MacArthur Foundation Genius Award. Chetty's research focuses on the ability of people, especially children from disadvantaged backgrounds, to improve their economic opportunities.
Professor Chetty, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
You've written that where children grow up shapes their prospects as adults. Explain that.
So we find when looking at very large data sets covering the American population that where a child grows up in America, which county they happen to grow up in, has a profound effect on their chances of moving up in the income distribution.
Like what cities?
Atlanta is a good example of a city that's quite sprawling, where there's a sharp division between where blacks and whites live, between where low income and high income families live. And lots of cities in America look like that. Detroit is another example of a city that looks like that. And those cities, there are various reasons you might think, you know, you'd get lower mobility in those areas, lower upward mobility. One of which is kids from disadvantaged backgrounds come into less contact with children from more affluent backgrounds. They have fewer role models, fewer people to kind of look up to and see the different career paths that you might pursue. They also have less resources in their public schools. So another strong correlated factor that we find is the quality of public schools in an area. Cities that tend to have better schools for middle-income families, they tend to have much better prospects for kids moving up in the income distribution.
You've looked at some 5 million children in the past few years. Tell me about the Dallas experiment and how it confirms what you've just been telling me.
Every extra year you spend in a better environment makes you more likely to go to college, less likely to have a teenage pregnancy, makes you earn more as an adult, makes you more likely to have a stable family situation, be married, for instance, when you're an adult. So in many dimensions, you see substantial improvements. Now, the Dallas study that you're referring to, or more generally, a set of work related to what's called the Moving to Opportunity Experiment, which gave families housing vouchers to move to better areas, confirms what I just described to you.
You're talking about black families primarily?
Black families and white families. This experiment involved a very large number of black families.
But poor people.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Families earning something like $10,000 a year. So really the low income population. And what this experiment did is it gave these families vouchers to rent apartments in better areas and lower poverty areas. And you got these vouchers just through a lottery. So by chance you might have gotten a voucher. And I also applied for this program and I didn't get a voucher. And what that does is it sets up an experiment where we can compare the outcomes of your kids with the outcomes of my kids and test, exactly like in a science experiment, whether this policy really seems to matter. Does where you grow up matter? And what we find is that there are really substantial effects for kids who move at young ages to better environments. If you move to a lower poverty area when you were, say, like 5 or 8 years old, you're earning 30% more as an adult, you're 30% more likely to go to college. There are all these very big improvements for both blacks and whites in many cities around the US.
Vouchers have been in effect for 45 or so years, and many of them have not worked.
Yeah, so I emphasized the result that if you move kids at young ages, you see substantial gains.
How young?
Below age 8, let's say. So, you know, when kids are early on in their lives. The other aspect, which is very important, is we have a big program, as you mentioned, of housing vouchers in the U.S., where we spend about $20 to $25 billion a year giving families vouchers to move to different areas. Those vouchers don't really encourage you in a particular way to move to better neighborhoods. And what we find is it really matters where you move, right?
Well, one of the things I read about your experiment in Dallas was from the Dallas Housing Authority chief, who said that the reality is that many benefited, but some have fallen under the bus. So how successful is this experiment, and is it in a position that you can broaden it out to other locations?
So that's a great question. So this experiment, the Moving to Opportunity Experiment, was conducted in several cities around the U.S., Baltimore, Chicago, New York, Los Angeles, and so on. We find pretty similar results across all of those areas. What makes it challenging as a policy that you'd kind of want to scale up to address poverty in the U.S. more broadly is you can't move everyone, right? You can move a small number of families, but your policy can't be you're just going to take everybody who lives in neighborhoods that you're worried about and move them somewhere else. And so ultimately, I think to really have an impact on poverty in the U.S., you have to go in and fix the neighborhoods that don't seem to be doing so well. So for example, the city of Baltimore is really detrimental. We estimate that if you grow up in Baltimore, you earn 30% less than if you grew up in the average place in America. Ultimately, the solution can't be you're going to move everybody out of Baltimore. You've got to figure out how you can fix things in Baltimore, I think.
How do you see this affecting the racial climate in this country?
25% of the gap in earnings between blacks and whites that all of us know about is driven simply by the fact that blacks tend to grow up in neighborhoods that are much worse on average than whites. And so because we have this vast disparity across areas in the U.S. in terms of the opportunities they're giving kids, we're actually amplifying these racial divisions.
When you look at these communities that you've talked about, what is the cost of racism?
I think there's a cost in terms of things like lost innovations that would occur if these children were given better opportunities. So let me give you an example. In some work we're doing at the moment, we look at where inventors come from, people who have patents. And we find that if you look at very talented kids who are scoring at the top of their class in terms of math scores, for instance, in third grade, if these kids are white and they're from affluent backgrounds, they're quite likely to go on and become an inventor, go on to patent something. If they're from if they're black or if they're from low-income families, they're much, much less likely, something like 10 times less likely, to go on to become inventors. So why is that an important fact? It says that if we give black kids and low socioeconomic status kids, even among white populations, better opportunities, not only helps them do better, but if they invent something that ends up benefiting society as a whole, they come up with a new drug or the new next iPhone, that's going to help everyone.
Well, thank you for joining us.
All right, thank you very much.
And for more on the series, please find the Race Matters page on the PBS NewsHour website.